He made a lot of mistakes in hadith. He was da'if in hadith. And he used the qiyas at the wrong time and in the wrong place. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa was from the
Murji'ah.
He was from the people of Ar-Ra'i. And that's a problem.
That's a problem.
The people of Ar-Ra'i, of opinions, they're the people who would say things like, what if?
What if?
Wallahi Ikhwani, I don't know, just like you don't know, if Abu Hanifa is in the Jannah or the Nar. I hope he's in the Jannah or he's in the Jannah.
Don't call him Al-Imam Al-A'zam.
These are dark times, there's no denying.
لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله
to discuss today a special topic about someone criticizing Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, saying bad things about Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. We want to go into a little bit of detail of that mas'ala. When we understand this, we have to also understand on one side and on the other side that the a'imma of jarh and ta'deel, the science of the investigative nature of the conditions of the narrators, the rawis, they were also very careful in their analyzing of every rawi. And we look at Imam Abu Hatim al-Razi. Once he is asked about some rawi, and he starts shaking and crying, and he says, "Do you know this jarh and talking, criticizing someone is a very delicate matter. It could take a person to Jahannam as well if he says wrong things." Imam Ibn Daqiq al-Eid rahmatullahi alayhi said in one place that though the ulama of jarh and ta'deel are on the edge and on the verge, on the kinara of Jahannam. If they criticize someone and they are speaking the truth, they are telling the truth, then they are throwing that person into Jahannam. But if they are lying, then they are throwing themselves into Jahannam. So you have to be very careful when you criticize an alim, a scholar, especially when someone is known to be of a very high caliber and a very great allama, alim, imam, muhaddith, faqih, and a mufassir, and who has knowledge in every field, and whose ibadat, worship, sakhawat, everything is well known, then you have to be very careful with regards to such personalities. Because in one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man aada lillahi waliyan, faqad baraza Allah bil muharaba." Whosoever holds hatred, enmity, dushmani, adawat with a friend of Allah, then he has called upon Allah for a battle and war. He is waging war against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in one hadith al-Qudsi, "When a friend of mine is accused, then I get into rage just as a lion gets into rage when the cub is attacked." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot take anything, any bad criticism of any of his friends. So mu'adat and enmity and hatred of awliyaullah is of a very grave nature. We have to be very careful with regards to that matter. When we understand this introduction, we will move on to the subject we are talking about. There is this video on YouTube by this person called Abu Usama al-Dhahabi. And he mentions Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh. Now, I have not met this person and I don't know how he is. I've just looked at his video as someone told me to have a look and give an answer, reply to the claims that have been made. I looked at the video several times and on the internet, and I made some points from there. One of my friends also sent me some points with regards to that. And with our students in Darul Ifta, we did some research, and we want to move forward with regards to the criticism made regarding Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. When we analyze the video, we see in there that Abu Usama makes some minor mistakes, some errors, and he makes some major mistakes. Minor mistakes, like for example, he starts off with Inna Alhamdulillah. He says Inna Alhamdulillah. When any student of Nahr knows that Inna Anna Ka Anna Lakinna Layta La'alla are Asma'i Nasiba, they give Nasib to the ism that follows it. So the correct pronunciation is Inna Alhamdulillah, with Nasib and Fatha on Alhamdulillah. He goes on, and in one place he says that Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi was born in the year 80 and he died in the year 105 at the age of 70. Now from 80 to 105 is not 70, it's 25. So the correct is Imam Abu Hanifa passed away in the year 150, which makes his age 70. In another place he goes on to say Alqama, student of Ibn Abbas. Now Alqama was not student of Ibn Abbas, he was a student of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. Famously known, Alqama ibn Qais al-Nakhai and Aswad ibn Yazid al-Nakhai. They were both very famous students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. And he, in one place he says, Shu'bah ibn al-Hujjaj. Now it's not al-Hujjaj, it's Hajjaj, with Fatha on the Ha. So these are some small mistakes, we can forgive for that. Many such mistakes can be taken out. However, when he goes on to make some claims which are major, we have to understand them. For example, when he starts off his lecture, he says that Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi only saw Anas ibn Malik and he never narrated from any of the Sahaba. Now, we want to ask, what are you trying to prove through this claim? Are you trying to say that Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi was not a tabi'i? If that is your claim, that I am sorry, it's wrong. Even if Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi did not narrate from any of the Sahaba, he just saw Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, that still makes him a tabi'i. Because Imam Ibn Salah writes in his Al-Muqaddama, page 79, التابعي من لقي الصحابي وإن لم يصحبه وهو الأقرب. Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi said, وهو الأظهر in Sharh Muslim. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahmatullahi alayhi writes in Al-Fatawa, Ibn Hajar al-Makki rahmatullahi alayhi writes in his Al-Fatawa, that لَقِيَ أَرْبَعَةً مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ غَيْرَ أَنَسِ وَهُمْ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ ibn Abi Awfa, وَسَهْلُ ibn Sa'd, وَعَبْدُ اللَّهِ ibn Unais, وَعَمْرُ ibn Hurais. Meaning that only looking at a Sahabi, seeing him, is enough to make a person tabi'i. So Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, not only did he see one Sahabi, he saw 5 Sahabas altogether, and he was born in the year 80 after Hijrah. And these Sahaba were still alive at that time. Hazrat Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu passed away in the year 95 or 96, and the others later on. So it is possible, and it's been proven in by the scholars in this book. I have a very nice book over here. First of all, I'll let you go through these books. This is the book of Al-Intiqa fi Fada'il al-A'immati al-Thalathati al-Fuqaha by Imam Abu Amr Yusuf ibn Abdul Bar al-Maliki rahmatullahi alayhi, al-Undalusi, who used to live in Undalus and Spain, and he has written the Fada'il of 3 Fuqahas, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. He has missed out Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi. He has only narrated the fada'il and manaqib virtues of these 3. Now, Abu Amr Yusuf ibn Abdul Bar is one of the earliest scholars. He was born in the year 368 and passed away in the year 463. So he was one of the first scholars to write regarding the manaqib and fada'il of these 3 fuqaha. And he has gone into great detail in mentioning the fada'il of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. It's a very good book, and he takes all things into account. Another book is over here, Makanatul Imam Abi Hanifa Bain al-Muhaddithin. This is of Dr. Muhammad Qasim Abduh al-Hadisi. A daktur means that he has done his doctorate degree, PhD, on Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah. And it's a very nice book. He has kept the balance of everything. He has taken everything into account, the objections made on Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, criticism made regarding him, and he has kept everything into perspective. It is right that sometimes the Hanafis did a little bit of ghulu and said things which were not true. So he has analyzed them and kept everything into its perspective, and it's a very nice book. Another book over here is Tazkiratul Nu'man. In Arabic it's called Uqudul Juman fi Manaqib al-Imam Abi Hanifa al-Nu'man by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Salihi al-Dimashqi al-Shafi'i. He is from the 9th century, a Shafi'i scholar, and many other books were written regarding Imam Abu Hanifa. Tabyidh al-Sahifa fi Manaqib al-Imam Abi Hanifa by Jalaluddin al-Suyuti rahmatullahi alayhi, and also by Hafiz Ibn Hajar al-Makki rahmatullahi alayhi al-Shafi'i as well. And we have over here in front of us Tariq-i-Baghdad of Khatib Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi. In it he has dedicated 120 pages to Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. And from those 120 pages, 50 are in praise of Imam Abu Hanifa and 70 are debatable, in which there is some criticism, some objections, and we can go through them, analyze them. Ustad Muhammad Abdul Al-Hadisi has analyzed all the i'tirazat and objections made by Khatib Baghdadi in this book, and he has given reply to all of them. Most of the objections refer to the chain of narration not being sound. Now, when we bring a hadith or anything, we need a sound chain of narration. And most of the narrations in criticism of Imam Abu Hanifa do not have a sound chain of narration. Therefore, they are da'if and weak, and we cannot take them into account, as Dr. Muhammad Qasim Abdul Al-Harisi has mentioned. Also, there are other books written in reply to the objections made by Khatib Baghdadi in that book as well. So, first claim that he did not see Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, we have dealt, oh, he only saw Imam Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, we have dealt with that. That is enough for Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi to be a tabi'i. He is the only Imam among the four Imams to be a tabi'i, because he was born in the year 80. Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi was born in the year 94. And Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi was born in the year 150, the same year which Imam Abu Hanifa died. And Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi was born in the year 164. So you can see that Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi is a tabi'i. He is the closest to the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The closer you are to the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the more virtues and fada'il you will be given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in one hadith, لا يأتي على الناس زمان إلا الذي بعده شر منه. Whenever a time comes upon a people, the one that follows will be worse than the one that has passed away. General rule, not always, this is aksari and aghlabi rule, that generally the later times are not as good as the earlier times. So Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi was very close to the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He is a tabi'i, there is no doubt about that. When moving on, after Abu Usama mentions this about Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he says that Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi was in a time of fitna. He did not start learning until a later age. And he goes on to say that there was Abdul Malik ibn Marwan and Walid bin Malik and fitna and no knowledge. And when so and so passed away, and then Abu Hanifa turned towards knowledge. Now these are all assumptions. Walid ibn Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, Walid bin Abdul Malik, they were in Dimashq. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah is in Kufa, and between Damascus and Kufa there is a great distance. Mm-hmm. So the fitnas that were taking place over there, where the Darul Khilafa was, Abu Hanifa was quite far away from there. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, of course, he was not into studying in his earlier age, but that was a reason behind. There was a reason behind it, and the reason was they had a family trade, and Imam Abu Hanifa was busy in that trade. So when he grew up, He had his basic necessary knowledge, and then he went into the family trade of selling clothes and rasham. So Imam Nasilk, Imam Amir ibn Sharahil al-Sha'bi, he saw Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, and he called him and he said, إِلَى مَنْ تَخْتَلِفُ, to whom do you go to? And Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi replied, I go to the market. And he said, no, I'm not talking about where you are going. I'm asking you, who is your teacher? Who is your ustad? And he replied, well, I'm not a man of that line. I have had my basic knowledge and now I'm now into this business. So he said, no, you should go and learn because I can see a ilm, a knowledge emanating from you. So Imam Abu Hanifa said, this was the first moment when he directed me, pushed me towards. Sometimes youngsters need this little bit of push. So Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi turned himself towards and he went on into the path of knowledge. And he sought a knowledge from the reliable scholars of the time, from within Kufa, within Basra. And he traveled to Baghdad and he traveled to Makkah Mukarramah, Medina Munawwara. He went for his first Hajj in the year 96 at the age of 16. He went with his father. There he saw one of the Sahaba, Abdullah ibn Unais radiallahu anhu, and he saw that they were sitting in a gathering and the Sahabi was narrating some hadith and he heard that hadith from him and which is being proven by other scholars. So he went for first Hajj and he went for another Hajj 2 years later on and he went for another Hajj after another 3 years in the year 101 and he went for another Hajj in the year 105 and another one later on. So he all in all performed nearly 15 Hajj throughout his life. Some fuqaha of Ahnaf says 55 Hajj, but Dr. Muhammad Abdu says that is not correct. The correct version is 15 Hajj he performed. And in one of those Hajj, he met up with Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi, who at that time had become a leading scholar of the city of Medina Munawwara. He benefited from him. And on these travels, he benefited from Ibn Shihab Zuhri rahmatullah alayhi, from Rabi'atul Rai in Medina Munawwara, from Ata ibn Abi Rabah in Makkah Mukarramah, and from Ikrimah and Qatada and others, big scholars. He benefited from them. So alhamdulillah, he took his knowledge from reliable sources. Allama Abdul Wahhab Sha'rani rahmatullah says that Imam Abu Hanifa's Masanid, his books about ahadith, have been published. And I have gone into detailed study. And I see that he only narrates from Khiyarut Tabi'een, from the Buzrugs and the high level of the Tabi'eens, he narrates those ahadith. And between him and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are only two or three narrators. Tabi'i and Sahabi and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or Tabi'i, Tabi'i, Tabi'i and Sahabi, because he was very close to the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he learned, he took ahadith from the ulama, from reliable sources. However, his favorite ustad from him who took fiqh was Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman. He used to teach in the Jami' Masjid of Al-Kufa. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi started sitting in his majlis and he took fiqh from him, this understanding, in-depth understanding of the Islamic jurisprudence. He learned from Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman. He stayed in his company for 10 years. And Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman used to revere and respect him, make him sit close to him. Once Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman had to travel to Basra and stay there for some family problem. He had to stay there for 2 months. So when he was going, he made Abu Hanifa sit on his place. And he said, take care of my place. And Masail should give reply to the questions that come forward. So Imam Abu Hanifa says, I used to give answers. And within these days, nearly 60 Masail came which were new to me, which had never turned up before Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman. So I gave the verdict with regards to those masail and I wrote down the verdict. When Hammad came, I presented it to them. He looked at them and he confirmed 40 of them and he took out some slight mistake in 20 of them. I realized that I have to stay in Hammad. I am not ripe and ready yet. I have to stay in his company. I spent my life with him as long as he was alive. When Hammad came back, his son asked him that, father, while you were away for 2 months, did you remember me? And Hammad said, beta, tell you the truth, I didn't remember you, but I did remember Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmatullah alayhi. I didn't remember you, but I did remember Abu Hanifa. He kept coming in my mind. That's how much love Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman had for Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmatullah alayhi. He stays in his company. Once Hammad was there, Abu Hanifa was there as well. And after the lesson, when Abu Hanifa got up, Hammad said to someone, this person, هَذَا مَعَ فِقْهِ وَوَرَعِهِ يَقُومُ اللَّيْلَ كُلَّهُ, that this young man, with his knowledge and with his taqwa and wara, he stands throughout the night in salah and in ibadah. That this young man is extremely pious. So Hammad also revered and held him in high esteem. This is Imam Abu Hanifa's rahmatullah alayhi's earlier days, and he's studying with the ulama of the time. Now, when moving on, Abu Usama says that many things, for example, he fell prey to many things that the awliya fell for. I don't know what he's trying to say through that. He said that the ulama criticized him. Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi said that if he were to say that this pillar is made from gold, then he could convince you. He can twist and turn things around and make you believe that this is from gold. Now, these are twisting and turning are the words of the criticizer. Now, we want to analyze the words of Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi. Abdullah ibn Mubarak says that Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi was seated, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi came, and he made space for him. They had a conversation together. When he went, Sufyan Thawri rahmatullah alayhi came, Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi showed respect to him as well. But the respect of Sufyan Thawri was not as much as the respect of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. When they went, Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullah alayhi says, or that Imam Malik made this comment, هذا أبو حنيفة لو كلمك في هذه السارية يجعلها ذهبا لقام بحجته. If he were to say that this pillar is made from gold, then he would stand firm with his evidence. Meaning the evidence he brings is quite clear. And he talks with proof and with evidence. He doesn't talk without dalil. Whatever he says is with dalil. So there will be dalil for that as well. He's trying to say how firm he is in his deduction of masail of deen. He is very firm, very strong. This is what he's trying to say. But people put it in the negative way. Abu Usama says that those who hate him take it in a negative way. Allahu Akbar, subhanallah. Can somebody hate an alim? Now, he translates the words, sometimes the words karahiyat are used. Karahiyat means dislikeness, not hate. Maybe among the ulama, sometimes there is some dislikeness for some reason. Like Abu Ishaq al-Fazali, he had some dislikeness for Imam Abu Hanifa. And Khatib Baghdadi, the most of the criticisms narrated are on the authority of Abu Ishaq al-Fazali. And he had some dislikeness for Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. So he narrated some things. So there's no hatred in there. Na'udhu billah, Imam Malik did not have any hatred for Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. They had great understanding and mutual respect for one another. So we shouldn't say that. He narrates from Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullah alayhi that Imam Ahmad said, don't write his hadith. La yuktabu hadithuhu. I went into detail to look for this. Where has Imam Ahmad said this? Now another thing is that Abu Usama does not give any references that it's on so-and-so page and so-and-so. Over here, I went into the reference. Khatib Baghdadi narrates on page 420, volume 6 of Tariq-e-Baghdad. حدثنا أحمد بن سعيد بن أبي مريم المصري قال فسألته يعني يحيى بن معين عن الإمام أبي حنيفة فقال لا تكتب حديثه. That this is the saying of يحيى بن معين, not of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. So instead of يحيى بن معين, he put the name of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And the answer to this criticism from يحيى بن معين is two in two ways. The narrator is أحمد بن سعيد كان كثير الوهم كثير الاضطراب. And number two, the second answer is Yahya ibn Ma'in used to do tawthiq of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh. In other place, he used to say that Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh is a trustworthy and reliable scholar. Yahya ibn Ma'in says in Al-Intiqa, the Hashi of Al-Intiqa narrates that وقال يحيى بن معين كان أبو حنيفة ثقة لا يحدث بالحديث إلا بما يحفظه ولا يحدث بما لا يحفظه. وقال صالح بن محمد سمعت يحيى بن معين يقول كان أبو حنيفة ثقة في الحديث. Abu Hanifa was a reliable authority in hadith. This is Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi regarding him. Yahya ibn Ma'in is saying in Hashiya of Al-Intiqa fi Fada'il al-A'immati al-Fuqaha, A'immati al-Thalatha al-Fuqaha, page number 246. Yahya ibn Ma'in himself says, and this I am narrating from Ibn Abdul Barr's Intiqa on page 204. He says, عن يحيى بن معين قال قال يحيى بن سعيد القطان أرأيتم إن عبنا على أبي حنيفة شيئا وأنكرنا بعض قوله أتريدون أن نترك ما نستحسن من قوله الذي يوقفنا عليه؟ قال ابن معين وكان يحيى بن سعيد القطان يذهب في الفتوى مذهب الكوفيين. This is يحيى بن معين narrating praise from يحيى بن سعيد القطان with regards to Imam Abu Hanifa رحمه الله عليه. Now with regards to Imam Ahmad, so this saying is not of يحيى بن معين. This saying is of this saying as narrated not from Imam Ahmad, it's originally from Yahya ibn Ma'in, and Yahya ibn Ma'in, the sanad is not reliable, therefore we cannot take that into account. Imam Ahmad rahmatullahi, what did he say regarding Imam Abu Hanifa? Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi. Now over here as well, when Abu Usama goes on, he says that Imam Ahmad was told that Abu Hanifa has been put in prison, and prison is a fitna. So Abu Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, Rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy on him. So this has been taken out of context. There are many mistakes in there. First mistake is that he is saying Ahmad ibn Hanbal was told that Abu Hanifa has been put in prison. Now Imam Ahmad was born in the year 164. And Imam Abu Hanifa passed away in the year 150. So how can he be told that Abu Hanifa has been put in prison? Did he come out of his grave and then be taken to prison? No, there is a mistake in there. What is that mistake? I looked into the mistake, and the original story is, Ustad Dr. Muhammad Abdul Al-Harisi narrates, that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal himself was in prison and he was being beaten up. And when he was given whips and slashes, someone told him that, oh Ahmad, Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi was also brought in this prison. He was also beaten up. Allah. So he said, Rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy on him. This is the actual story, and which has been twisted and turned into another way. And Imam and it's been portrayed in such a way, and using the words that prison is fitna, and Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi was put in fitna, in prison, because he went to the rulers. Abu Hanifa didn't go to the rulers. He was forced by the rulers to take upon the qadha and judiciary system, and he refused. And for that reason, he was beaten up by the qudat and by the hukam. So there is mistake in there as well. This is one of the objections. Talking about criticism, he says that Sufyan Thawri rahmatullahi alayhi used to make the dua seeing a crippled person when he saw Abu Hanifa, that Allah does not make happen to him what happened to the imam. Meaning, when you see a crippled person, handicapped, disabled person, or someone with any illness, then the hadith says, if you read this dua, Alhamdulillah, alladhi aafani mimma btalahu bihi, wa faddalani ala kathirin mimman khalaqa tafdeela. All praise is due for Allah, who protected me from the illness with which he has tried this person, who has given me excellence and virtue over many among his creation. If you read this dua, Allah will protect you from that illness by which the other person is afflicted. So this is the hadith. Now, Abu Usama says that Sufyan Thawri, when he would look at Abu Hanifa, he would recite this dua. That, oh, thank God, Allah, that I am not like Abu Hanifa. This is the way in which it's narrated. What is the real story? The real story has been narrated by Khatib Baghdadi in his tarikh on page 423. Khatib Baghdadi says that Sufyan Thawri rahmatullahi alayhi was in Makkah Mukarrama when Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi passed away. Kana Sufyan Thawri fi Makkah lamma mata Abu Hanifa. Faqila lahu mata. And he was informed of the death of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. And he said, Alhamdulillah alladhi aafani mimma btalahu bihi. Alhamdulillah, Allah, all praise is due for Allah, who kept me in peace and security from that with which he tried him. What is he referring to? The reference is that the Qazi and Amir, the governor, Ibn Abi Hubayra, had sent out a warrant for Imam Abu Hanifa and Sufyan Thawri, both of them. Sufyan Thawri rahmatullahi alayhi managed to escape and flee to Makkah Mukarramah. But Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi did not escape. He took on his chin whatever came upon him. And he went to the jail, and he was whipped, and he was lashed, and he has suffered, and then he was poisoned to death. So Abu Sufyan Thawri was referring to that incident, that Allah ka shukar, that I was not, Allah knows what would have happened to me if I was tried in the same way Abu Hanifa was tried. Meaning he was praising Abu Hanifa Ramdulali of his istiqamat and the way he stood firm upon the trials that came upon him. And he said, if I had been tried, Allah knows what would have happened to me. This is the real story, and you can understand how it's being twisted, that Abu Sufyan Thawri said that thank God that I am not like Abu Hanifa. That's not the case. This is the real story. So this is how the things are being twisted in the criticism. Moving on. He would use qiyas on hadith at the wrong place, at the wrong time. He was of the people of Rai. That's a problem. What if? Now, this is also something debatable. Na'udhu billah, he would use qiyas at the wrong time and qiyas over hadith. Now, he would never give preference to qiyas over hadith.
Nobody has ever
done. Can a Muslim do that?
No.
Any Muslim, no Muslim can give preference to his own rai and logic over the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we can understand that there is something fishy in there. Let me narrate just one thing from Imam Ibn Taymiyyah. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhi writes in Majmu'ul Fatawa, page 304, volume 20, وَمَنْ ظَنَّ بِأَبِي حَنِيفَةَ أَوْ غَيْرِهِ مِنْ أَيْمَّةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ أَنَّهُمْ يَتَعَمَّدُونَ مُخَالَفَةَ الْحَدِيثِ الصَّحِيحِ لِقِيَاسٍ أَوْ غَيْرِهِ فَقَدْ أَخْطَأَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَتَكَلَّمَ إِمَّا بِظَنٍّ وَإِمَّا بِهَوَى فَهَذَا أَبُو حَنِيفَةَ يَعْمَلُ بِحَدِيثِ التَّوَضِّي بِالنَّبِيذِ فِي السَّفَرِ مُخَالَفَةً لِلْقِيَاسِ وَبِحَدِيثِ الْقَهْقَهَةِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ مَعَ مُخَالَفَتِهِ لِلْقِيَاسِ لِاعْتِقَادِهِ صِحَّتَهُمَا وإن كان أئمة الحديث لم يصححوهما وقد بينا هذا في رسالتنا رفع الملام عن الأئمة الأعلام وبينا أن أحدا من أئمة الإسلام لا يخالف حديثا صحيحا بغير عذر بل لهم نحو من 20 عذرا. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayhi writes, whosoever thinks that Abu Hanifa or other Aimma from the Aimma of Muslimin used to deliberately contradict a sahih hadith due to qiyas or another reason, then he is mistaken. And he is talking with only his conjecture or with his whim and desire. Imma bi zannin wa imma bi hawa. Then he goes, this is Abu Hanifa, who is practicing upon the hadith of performing wudu with nabid in safar, even though it's against the logic. And he is practicing on the hadith of qahqaha, laughing loudly in salah, even though it is against the logic. The two references are, nabiz is that water in which some dates are soaked, and the water takes the color of the dates, maybe the taste of the date. So if someone is on a journey, he has no other water to perform wudu with, he either performs wudu with that nabiz or with the tayammum. Then Imam Abu Hanifa says, no, don't do tayammum, use that nabiz and do wudu, because there is a hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, tamaratun tayyibatun wa ma'un tahurun, give me, and he performed wudu with that nabiz. It was not thick, it was only, the dates had been thick, only the slight color was there, so he said, it's still water, it's still light, and it's usable, and he performed wudu with it. So he said, wudu with nabiz is better than doing tayammum. If someone laughs during salat, ha 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 ha, loudly, then his salah will break. But one hadith says that someone laughed in salah and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, go and do your wudu again, because your wudu is broken as well. Now wudu only breaks by maybe urine or stool or wind or blood coming out or vomit. Qahqaha fi salat isn't, it's not one of the nawaqid of wudu. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said over here that go and perform wudu. So Imam Abu Hanifa said, qahqaha fi salat will break wudu even though it's against qiyas. So Imam Abu Hanifa never gives preference to qiyas over hadith. He uses a hadith over qiyas. He says in one place, ma ja'a anillahi wa rasulihi sallallahu alaihi wasallam fa'ala ar-ra'si wal 'ain. Wa ma ja'a anis sahaba ikhtarna. Wa ma ja'a anit tabi'in zahamnahu. When something comes from Allah and His Rasul, it's upon our heads and our eyes. And whenever something comes from the Sahaba, then we will choose from the Sahaba, because Sahaba differ among themselves in verdicts of Shariat. So we will choose which one is more closer to Quran and Hadith, and we will give verdict according to that. And when something comes from Tabi'een, then we will struggle with them. Meaning if something comes from Hasan Basri, Sa'id bin Musayyib, Qatada, Ikrimah, Nafi, all these Tabi'een, then Imam Abu Hanifa himself is a Tabi'i as well. So as they did research, he can do research as well. So he said, we will do research like they did research, and then we will come to a verdict. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi never contradicted hadith and never went against any hadith deliberately or without any valid reason. In fact, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi used to take the athar of Sahaba as well. There is in Al-Intiqa, there is this athar that once Zuhair ibn Muawiyah says, I asked Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi regarding the aman of al-abd, slave. If a slave is with the Muslim army and he gives an aman and protection to a particular person from the enemies, is that allowed or not? Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi replied, if he was participating in the battle, then his aman is allowed. If not, then not allowed. So Zuhair ibn Muawiyah says, well, there is an athar of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, that during his time once, the Muslim army had surrounded a group, and someone sent threw a note to them, and that they took the note, and in that note there was protection and aman for them. So they came out, they laid down their arms. So the Muslim army was about to attack them. They said, you have given us aman and protection, why are you attacking us now? He said, who gave you aman? And they said that this is your note which has been sent to us, and that note was sent by a slave who was not actively participating in the battle. So they said that this was by a slave, we didn't give it. And the enemy said, how do we know where the note came from? It was just sent to us. How do we know who sent it? So we have been given protection. They sent someone to Umar radiallahu anhu, and Umar said that the aman and the protection given by the slave is also valid and you can't touch them. So they were given protection because of that. So Zuhair ibn Muawiyah says, when I related this hadith to him, he said, then we will have to give verdict according to the asar of Umar radiallahu anhu. Zuhair says, I came back after 1 year and I met him again and I asked him the same masla, and he gave the verdict according to the asar of Umar radiallahu anhu, and he narrated the asar of Umar radiallahu anhu. I realized that Abu Hanifa only gives fatwa according to athar and not according to his logic. He finds athar and ahadith as much as he can. He never gives preference to his qiyas over logic. And Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri rahmatullahi alayhi has written this in somewhere in Muhalla. جميع أصحاب أبي حنيفة مجمعون على أن الحديث الضعيف أولى بالعمل من القياس. All the students of Abu Hanifa agree on this fact that a ضعيف hadith is more worthy of being practiced upon than the logic and the analogy of an individual person. So this is fabrication, a lie upon Imam Abu Hanifa, in the words of Imam Ibn Taymiyyah from his Majmu' al-Fatawa, page 304, volume 20. He said, we have explained in our Risala, Raf'ul Malam an al-Aimmatil A'lam. We have explained that no Imam among the Aimmas of Muslimin has contradicted or gone against a Sahih Hadith without a valid reason. In fact, they had nearly 20 reasons for leaving a Sahih Hadith. 20 reasons he mentioned. Maybe this, maybe this, maybe this, maybe this. There are many Sahih Ahadith. But you have to leave that Sahih Hadith for some reason. Not only these Aimmas. This is another debate. Sometimes the Sahabas, they used to have, there was no chain of narration for the Sahaba. When some Sahabi narrates a hadith for a Sahabi, then Sahabas are all reliable, they don't lie. So that hadith is true, but still Sahaba said, no, there is something in there, we will not practice on this, we will practice on another hadith. Let me give you an example. Busra bint Safwan narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whosoever touches his private part, his wudu is broken. Man massa dhakarahu falyatawadda. Now when this hadith is brought in front of Sahaba, they say, no, even though this hadith is sahih, Busra heard it with her ears, maybe there is something behind it. We heard something else from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we will practice on that. So they left the hadith of Busra bint Safwan, they practiced upon another hadith of Talq ibn Ali radiallahu anhu, in which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, hal huwa illa bada'atun minka, it's only a part of your body, you touch your nose, you touch your private part, it's same, it doesn't break the wudu. So whenever someone leaves a hadith, there is some reason behind it. Ibn Taymiyyah has mentioned 20 reasons for leaving a sahih hadith, that for the Aimmah. So this is a baseless accusation upon Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh that he would give preference to his qiyas over asar, and he would use the qiyas at the wrong place at the wrong time. Na'uzu billah, he would never do that. Let me mention an incident to you. No, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh was of a very high caliber. First of all, let me tell you, Imam Abu Hanifa is not God. He is not Allah. He is not Rasulullah. He is a Muslim, a mu'min, a believer, and he is an alim, he is a scholar, he does his research, and he put his research for the ummah and made things easy for the ummah to practice. We don't worship Abu Hanifa, we only trust him and have confidence in the research which he has done, and we say that rather than accepting the research of someone from today, we have more confidence in the research of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh was confronted with jealousy on many occasions. People were jealous of him. They used to accuse him, abuse him during his lifetime as well. But he was a very patient, tolerant person. And his ibadat, his wara', taqwa, we will come to that. Once Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah was giving a dars, and during the dars, someone got up from behind. And he said, this incident is narrated by Sheikh Zakariya al-Kandalwi al-Muhajir al-Madani rahmatullah alayhi in Muqaddama Awjazul Masalik. In the biography of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, he says that once Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi was giving dars, and someone stood up from behind and he said, "Da'u hadi ya Abu Hanifa, da'u hadihi al-muqayasa, fa inna awwala man qasa iblis." Oh Abu Hanifa, leave aside these analogies and qiyas of yours. The first person to do qiyas was Iblis. He said that ana khayrun minhu khalaqtani min narin wa khalaqtahu min teen. I am better than Adam. You created me from fire and he from clay. Fire is better than clay. Why should I worship to him? So he used his analogy. So don't use your analogy. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, cool as a cucumber. He said, ya haza wada'ta ash-shay'a fi ghayri mahallihi. Iblis radda bi qiyasihi 'ala Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala amrahu. وَنَحْنُ نَدُورُ حَوْلَ الْإِتِّبَعِ فَكَيْفَ نُسَاوِي إِبْلِيسِ. Oh my friend, you have put the thing in the wrong place. You have taken it out of context. Iblis, through his analogy, rejected the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we, through the analogy, look for and search for the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so we can practice on it. So how can we be equal to Iblis? He is rejecting and we are looking for it. So there is a difference between them. And the person was of a good, sound nature. And he said, sorry, my ghalattu wa tubtu, I made a mistake. And thank you very much. Nawwara Allahu qalbak kama nawwarta qalbi. May Allah enlighten your heart just as you have enlightened my heart. So, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi never used to give preference to qiyas over the asar. And this is a great, you know, we can go into detail. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah's quote is enough for us. He is Shaykh al-Islam, and in his fatwa he has said this. In fact, Imam Zahabi rahmatullah alayhi also writes in Sir A'lam al-Nubala on page 390, volume 6. As soon as he starts Imam Abu Hanifa's biography, he writes, Abu Hanifa, al-Imam, faqihul millah, alimul Iraq, عني بطلب الآثار وارتحل في ذلك وأما التدقيق في الرأي وغوامضه فإليه المنتهى والناس عيال عليه في ذلك. And Abu Hanifa, he is the Imam, he is the Faqih of Millat, he is the Alim of Iraq, and he paid great attention in search of Athar and Ahadith, and he traveled to learn Ahadith and in this matter. And as for going into the in-depth of Rai, and for the Tadqiq and the Ghawamiz, Rai and the Ghawamiz, the hidden aspects of the Rai, then for إِلَيْهِ الْمُنْتَهَى. To him is the Muntaha, the ending, final ending. And وَالنَّاسُ عِيَالٌ عَلَيْهِ فِي ذَلِكَ. People are like children to him in this matter, that they have to learn from him. And this is, he is quoting the quote of his Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi, أَلْنَاسُ عِيَالٌ عَلَىٰ أَبِي حَنِيفَةَ فِي الْفِقْهِ. So this is with regards to his words of praise in Sir A'lam al-Nubala for Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. Moving on, he was from the deviant sect Murji'a. Another claim made by Abu Usama in his talk is that he was from the deviant sect Murji'a, no doubt about it. That's his words. No doubt about it that he was from the deviant sect Murji'a. Allahu Akbar. First of all, when he explains who are the Murji'a, he says that the Murji'a are those people who used to say that once you say the kalima La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, you are in Jannah. No matter what you do, whether you pray Salah or you don't pray, you keep fast or you don't keep, you commit zina, fornication, murder, whatever you do, your iman is at the high level of like iman of Jibreel and Mikael and Israfil and iman of Muhammad and Musa and Yusuf. Your iman, their iman is same. And you will definitely, you will go straight into Jannah, whatever you do, because you've said this kalma, you will be with. Of course, this was the belief of the Murji'ah. Now, let me ask you, was this the belief of Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi? No. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi has this book called Al-Fiqh al-Akbar. And on page 77, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi writes, وَلَا نَقُولُ إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنَ لَا تَضُرُّهُ الذُّنُوبُ وَأَنَّهُ لَا يَدْخُلُ النَّارُ وَلَا أَنَّهُ يُخَلَّدُ فِيهَا وَإِنْ كَانَ فَاسِقًا بَعْدَ أَنْ يَخْرُجَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا مُؤْمِنًا وَلَا نَقُولُ إِنَّ حَسَنَاتِنَا مَقْبُولَةٌ وَسَيِّئَاتِنَا مَغْفُورَةٌ كَقَوْلِ الْمُرْجِيَةِ. What is he saying? وَلَا نَقُولُ كَقَوْلِ الْمُرْجِيَةِ. We are not saying the saying of Murjiya that all our hasanats are maqbool and all our sayyat are forgiven. And no matter what you do, you will go in Jannah. We don't say this. ولكن نقول المسألة مبينة مفصلة من عمل حسنة بشرائطها خالية عن العيوب المفسدة والمعاني المبطلة ولم يبطلها حتى خرج من الدنيا فإن الله لا يضيعها بل يقبلها منه ويثيبه عليها وما كان من السيئات دون الشرك والكفر ولم يتب عنها حتى مات مؤمنا فإنه في مشية الله إن شاء عذبه وإن شاء عفا عنه ولم يعذبه بالنار أبدا. When a person commits sins, then he will be in the mashiyat and of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wills, he can punish him. If Allah wills, he can pardon him. It is in the hands of Allah. We don't say that he will be going straight into Jannah. This is Aqidah Tahawiyyah. Matnul Aqidah Tahawiyyah lil Imam Abi Ja'far. At-Tahawi rahmatullahi. Imam Tahawi rahmatullahi starts off his aqidah by saying, هذا ذكر بيان عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة على مذهب فقهاء الملة أبي حنيفة النعمان بن ثابت الكوفي وأبي يوسف يعقوب بن إبراهيم الأنصاري وأبي عبد الله محمد بن الحسن الشيباني رضوان الله عليهم أجمعين وما يعتقدون من أصول الدين ويدينون به لرب العالمين. This aqidah is according to the aqidah of these three great imams, Abu Hanifa, Abu Yusuf, and Muhammad bin Hassan. نقول في توحيد الله معتقدين بتوفيق الله إن الله واحد لا شريك له ولا شيء مثله ولا شيء يعجزه ولا إله غيره. Very nice, beautiful, small compilation of aqid. It's been translated and it's been commentaries have been written on it many times. In the book, Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayh writes within the aqid. Aqidah number 58. وَلَا نَقُولُ لَا يَضُرُّ مَعَ الْإِيمَانِ ذَنْبٌ لِمَنْ عَمِلَهُ. We don't say that when you have iman, then sins will never harm you, even though you commit sins. We don't say this. وَنَرْجُو لِلْمُحْسِنِينَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنْ يَعْفُوَ عَنْهُمْ وَيُدْخِلَهُمُ الْجَنَّةَ بِرَحْمَتِهِ وَلَا نَأْمَنُ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا نَشْهَدُ لَهُمْ بِالْجَنَّةِ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُ لِمُسِيئِهِمْ وَنَخَافُ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا نُقَنِّطُهُمْ. So Imam Tahawi rahmatullah alayhi is saying that those who are doing good from mu'mineen, we will have high hopes for them. That Allah will forgive their minor mistakes and Allah will admit them into Jannah with His mercy. However, we will not feel secure upon them. Even though someone have my good deeds, but Allah can still hold to account for small deeds, small sins and minor sins as well. Similarly, we will not say, testify that someone is guaranteed Jannah. No one is guaranteed Jannah. Allah knows who is going into Jannah. And we will do istighfar for a person who makes mistakes and sins. And we will fear for them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can seize them and hold them to account. وَلَا نُقَنِّطُهُمْ. However, we will not make them despondent of the mercy of Allah. We will not make them hopeless. We will tell them to do tawbah and istighfar. So this is what Imam Tahawi rahmatullahi writes over here. This completely against the aqidah of Murji'ah. How can you say that Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi was a Murji'ah? This is a baseless claim. Because when you say the word Murji'ah, the mind goes towards this aqidah. And this was not the aqidah of Imam Abu Hanifa, of Imam Abu Yusuf, of Imam Tahawi, of Imam Muhammad, nor is it our aqidah. So don't blame upon us something which we don't say and which we totally contradict. This book is in your hand, it's in every household, you can read it for yourself. There is the English translation in there as well. So, this is, we have dealt with the claim that he was from the Murji'ah. What is the reality of this? We can go into detail, but I think we will be losing a lot of time, so I don't want to go in there. Abu Hanifa, he says that one of the greatest things is that Abu Hanifa permitted revolting against the ruler. This is also baseless. Imam Abu Hanifa Rahmatullah Alayhi writes in his book Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar, narrated by Ar-Raddu Al-Khatib, page 61. وَلَا نَرَى الْخُلُوجَ عَلَىٰ أَئِمَّتِنَا وَوُلَاتِ أُمُورِنَا وَإِنْ جَارُوا عَلَيْنَا وَنَدْعُوا لَهُمْ. Similar words are narrated over here by Imam Tahawi Rahmatullah Alayhi in his Aqidah. Imam Tahawi says, وَلَا نَرَى السَّيْفَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْ أُمَّةِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِلَّا مَنْ وَجَبَ عَلَيْهِ السَّيْفِ وَلَا نَرَى الْخُرُوجَ عَلَىٰ أَئِمَّتِنَا وَوُلَاتِ أُمُورِنَا وَإِنْ جَارُوا وَلَا نَدْعُوا عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا نَنْزِعُ يَدًا مِّنْ طَاعَتِهِمْ وَنَرَى طَاعَتَهُمْ مِّنْ طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فَرِيضَةً مَا لَمْ يَأْمُرُوا بِمَعْصِيَةٍ وَنَدْعُوا لَهُمْ بِالصَّلَاحِ وَالْمُعَافَاتِ. This is the reality of the Aqidah, that we will not say that you should go out and revolt against the Imam and the Wulatul Umur, even though they may be committing injustice and persecution. We will not even make baddua against them, curse against them. We will not pull out our hands from their obedience. We see that we believe that obedience to the those who have been given the authority is like from the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which Allah has commanded us to do so. As long as they don't tell you to do any sin and ma'siyat, we will make dua for them that Allah guide them and Allah give them the path of piety and Allah give them peace and security. This is the way we will deal with our a'immah. So, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi did not say revolting against the Imam and Allah. He narrates that Imam Abu Zahir rahmatullahi, who is bigger and better than the four Imams. Now this is just a baseless claim. Imam Abu Zahir rahmatullahi, if he was bigger and better, where is his mazhab today? Why is his mazhab not prevail? Imam Abu Zahir was in Sham. Of course, he was a big alim, great alim of that era. But he was not bigger nor better than the four imams. Imam Abu Zahir, he says that Abdullah ibn Mubarak was sitting with Imam Abu Zahir. And Abu Hanifa came. So Imam Abu Zahir stood up and went away. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak followed him. Why did you run away? He said, I don't want to sit with a person who feels that revolting against the Imam is allowed. Now this story has been narrated by Khatib Baghdadi in his Tariq. And I have looked it up in his Tariq. And page 385. The narrator of that story is Abu Ishaq al-Fazari. Now Abu Ishaq al-Fazari, just as I mentioned before, he had some karahiyat and dislikeness for Abu Hanifa. And he used to do these things. Over here in Al-Intiqa, Ibn Abdul Bar Maliki says, عن إسماعيل ابن أبي داود قال كان ابن المبارك يذكر عن أبي حنيفة كل خير ويزكيه ويقرضه ويثني عليه وكان أبو إسحاق الفزاري يكره أبا حنيفة وكانوا إذا اجتمعوا لم يجتري أبو إسحاق أن يذكر أبا حنيفة بحضرة ابن المبارك بشيء. Abu Ishaq, when he was in the majlis where Abdullah ibn Mubarak was, he would never dare to say anything bad about Abu Hanifa. At other times he would do so. But in the majlis of Abdullah ibn Mubarak, he would never have the courage to do so. Abu Ishaq Fazari is the narrator of this incident from Abdullah ibn Mubarak. That Abu Awza'i and Abdullah ibn Mubarak and stories been mentioned. And so, first of all, the narrator is not reliable, and therefore the story cannot be taken into account. We have mentioned from this matn of Aqidah Tahawiyyah, from Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar, that Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh never allowed revolting against the Imam. So this is also another baseless accusation. Moving on, Imam Shu'bah ibn al-Hujjaj of Iraq, again he says Hujjaj, not Hajjah, it's Hajjaj. Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj of Iraq Basra, a contemporary of Abu Hanifa, used to curse Abu Hanifa. Na'udhu billah, Shu'bah never cursed Abu Hanifa. He never cursed Imam Abu Hanifa. Let me narrate to you from Ibn Abdul Barz al-Intiqa. As I mentioned, he's one of the earliest scholars to write in praise of Imam Abu Hanifa. He writes on page 196, عن شبابت ابن سوار قال كان شعبت حسن الرأي في أبي حنيفة. Shu'bah was had a good opinion verdict regarding Abu Hanifa. In another place he says عن عبد الصمد بن عبد الوارث قال كنا عند شعبة بن الحجاج فقيل له مات أبو حنيفة فقال شعبة لقد ذهب معه فقه الكوفة تفضل الله علينا وعليه برحمته. We were with Shu'bah and he was informed that Imam Abu Hanifa has died and Shu'bah said with him has gone the jurisprudence of Kufa. May Allah shower his grace and his mercy upon us and upon him. In another place in Makanatul Imam Abu Hanifa, Dr. Muhammad Abdul Hadisi narrates on page 199, Kana wallahi hasan al-fahmi jayyid al-hifzi. Shu'bah says, wallah, Abu Hanifa had a very good understanding and he had a very strong memory and hifz, jayyid al-hifzi. This is the verdict of Shu'bah. Abdullah ibn Ahmad ibn Ibrahim al-Dawraqi says, Yahya ibn Ma'in was asked while I was listening regarding Abu Hanifa. And Yahya ibn Ma'in replied, ثِقَةٌ مَا سَمِعْتُ أَحَدًا ضَعَّفَهُ هَذَا شُعْبَةُ بْنُ الْحَجَّاجِ يَكْتُبُ إِلَيْهِ أَنْ يُحَدِّثَ وَيَأْمُرُهُ وَشُعْبَةُ شُعْبَةُ. Yahya ibn Ma'in replied that Abu Hanifa is thiqa. I have not heard of anyone making him weak. Look at this Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj. He is writing to Abu Hanifa that you should narrate ahadith. And he is giving him instruction to narrate ahadith. And Shu'bah is Shu'bah. He wouldn't tell anyone to do this unless he knew that person was reliable. Another mistake over here he makes is, he says Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj al-Basri. Shu'bah is not Basri, Shu'bah is al-Wasiti. He used to live in the city of Wasit, which is between Kufa and Basra. Kufa on one side, Basra on one side, and the middle is Wasit. Shu'bah was al-Wasiti, and his ilm was spread from there. So, Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj used to have a good opinion with regards to Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi alayhi, and this claim that he used to curse Abu Hanifa, how can a mu'min curse someone? Now, Abu Usama, you know, he says that Shu'bah used to curse Abu Hanifa, and then he says, oh, this is not a good thing to do, because laysa al-mu'min bit-ta'an wal-la'an. So, on one side, he is again criticizing Shu'bah as well. That why did Shu'bah curse Abu Hanifa? He shouldn't have cursed him because the hadith says you shouldn't curse anyone. So, you know, these are silly mistakes which are being made. When you, the reason which I mentioned in the beginning, when you start criticizing someone, you have to be very careful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like it when you criticize one of his friends. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi was a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He didn't like inventing things into the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a very pious servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Moving on, some of the other things are left. With regards to Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi, he said that between Bainahu wa Bain al-Haqq hijab. This is narrated by Tariq in Tariq Baghdad, page 208. Allah knows best what he means by that. Let's take to account, this was statement of Abdul Rahman ibn Mahdi. The sound change is reliable as well. There is one person criticizing him. But on the other hand, if you take all those people who are praising him, who are more in number, and I will come to that point as well. Because Abu Usama says in his lecture that so-and-so people criticized him. Where is it? He says, Bukhari, Muslim, Nasa'i, Ibn Ma'in, Darqutni, Awza'i, Ibn Adi, Ibn Habban, they all said he is da'if. I will say, is that all? Seven people? Look at this Al-Intiqaf Ibn Abdul Barr. He has narrated praise of Imam Abu Hanifa from nearly 70 scholars. So if seven are on one side, 70 on the other side, the rule of Jarh and Ta'deel is, when Ta'deel is more and Jarh is less, then Ta'deel supersedes the Jarh. So you will pay to the ta'deel, the praise, and not to the jarh. So even if there was Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi, for whatever reasons, he said in one place that Abu Hanifa was da'if in his Tariq al-Saghir. Take it his view. Muslim, I don't know where Muslim said this. We need a reference. Nasa'i, yes, Nasa'i's reference we have found that Nasa'i said da'if. With regards to Ibn Ma'in, no. Ibn Ma'in said he is thiqa. We have just mentioned the reference. Daraqutni has said Abu Hanifa is da'if. But Allama Badruddin Aini rahmatullahi gives reply to that in Umdatul Qari Sharh al-Bukhari. In one place he says, مِنْ أَيْنَ لِلْدَارَقُطْنِ تَضْعُوفُ تَضْعِيفُ وَبِي حَنِيفَ وَهُوَ مُسْتَحِقٌ لِلْتَضْعِيفُ فَإِنَّهُ رَوَى فِي مُسْنَدِهِ أَحَادِيثَ مُنْكَرَةً وَاهِيَةً. That how dare Daraqutni say Abu Hanifa is daif when he himself is deserved to be made daif. Because he in his Musnad had narrated so many hadith which are Munkar and Wahi. So he deserves the Tadhib, not Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh. So Daraqutni's statement and Ibn Adi's statement cannot be taken into account. Ibn Adi, Daraqutni, their ta'assub of mazhab is well known. So with regards to Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh, these 70 scholars, I don't even want to go into the detail of the names in there. Maybe if there is time, we will mention the name of all of them. Some of them which I have just noted to you, Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj, Sufyan Thawri, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Hamad ibn Zayd, Ibn Shubruma, Yahya al-Qattan, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Yahya ibn Ma'in, Ibn Jurayj, Waqiy, they are all praising Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi. Sufyan Thawri, he mentioned that with regards to Sufyan Thawri about the crippled person. Let me tell you what Sufyan Thawri rahmatullahi used to say regarding Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak qal, سمعت الثوري يقول كان أبو حنيفة شديد الأخذ للعلم ثابا عن حرم الله أن تستحل يأخذ بما صح عنده من الأحاديث التي كان يحملها الثقات وبالآخر من فعل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبما أدرك عليه علماء الكوفة ثم شنع عليه قوم يغفر الله لنا ولهم. This is the statement of Sufyan Thawri narrated by Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Who has narrated this? Ibn Abdul Barr in Al-Intiqa, page 262. Ibn Abdul Barr narrates. Before all these things come into place, Ibn Abdul Barr. And let me tell you something else. Ibn Abdul Barr passed away in the same year as Tariq Baghdadi, Khatib Baghdadi passed away. 462. Okay. And Tariq Baghdadi, Khatib Baghdadi wrote both types and he wrote many fabricated stories in criticism of Abu Hanifa rahmatullah. But Ibn Abdul Barr didn't pay any attention to those fabricated stories. He said there are people like Bukhari ibn Hibban who criticized him. He mentioned a little bit, but he had the insaf and justice in his wording. He had respect. And this is what we need to do. We live in this country which is civilized. And in a scholarly debate, we need to have respect. And this respect should be shown. And in every criticism, there needs to be reference. So in these criticism, the reference should be given. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi was of a sound nature, and these criticisms have been made, and most of them are fabricated allegations. We are not saying we are taking Abu Hanifa as God or Rasulullah or Allah. No, we are keeping the things into perspective and saying Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi was a great imam. He was a wali of Allah. He was a muhaddis. He was a faqih, and he was a great abid and zahid, and you go into his characteristics and you know, you just wonder and marvel at such a person. He was a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sunnah and his way is that he takes the work of deen from people and he chooses people. And in every era, whatever need is there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses people to do that work. In the Sahaba, Tabi'een, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, you see that time, the need, Allah fulfilled the need through them. When Imam Bukhari's time comes, the need is for Sahih Ahadith. So Allah chooses Imam Bukhari to gather collection, good compilation and encyclopedia of Sahih Ahadith. But when you look at the time of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, people knew Ahadith, they had memorized Ahadith like memorizing Quran. But their attention was not towards taking out masail from the Quran and Hadith. Nadr ibn Shumail says, كَانَ النَّاسُ نِيَامًا عَنِ الْفِقْهِ حَتَّى أَيْقَظَهُمْ أَبُو حَنِيفَ بِمَا فَتَقَهُ وَبَيَّنَهُ وَلَخَّصَهُ. People were sleeping from fiqh. It was Abu Hanifa who woke them up by explaining and beautifully summarizing the masail, the usul and the roots and how to derive masail from Quran and Hadith. So he said that don't just memorize, with memorizing, take out the masail from the Quran and Hadith as well. So Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi diverted people's attention towards this fiqh which was necessary and which was needed. So these are some of the criticism. We are moving on very quickly and swiftly, a little bit left. Another criticism made is that Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi criticizes Imam Abu Hanifa in Sahih al-Bukhari. First of all, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi has never mentioned the name of Imam Abu Hanifa in his whole Sahih. In never in a single place. In some places he says, قَالَ بَعْضُ النَّاسِ. And this is not criticism, this is a difference of opinion. That Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi's opinion is different from the opinion of some people. And Imam Bukhari uses this qala ba'zu an-nas in maybe 20 to just over 20 places. And in most places, he directs his indication towards Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah. In some places towards Imam Shafi'i as well. And in one place towards Imam Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani as well. So, this is with regards to Ba'adhu al-Nas. And criticizing him in Sahih al-Bukhari, Abu Usama says through the abwab, through the chapters which he conducts, he uses. Now, Imam Bukhari rahmatullah was a very wise person. You know, he would not write his Sahih just to criticize one person. He wrote his Sahih for the whole Ummah. He wanted the whole Ummah to benefit from his Sahih. So, wherever there is a difference of opinion, he will of course support his view and he will bring hadith in his view. Now, in Kitabul Iman, many shurra say in the beginning he brings abwab, like this is from a'mal from Iman, amal part of Iman, amal part of Iman, minal Iman, kaza wa kaza. And he's indicating towards Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh. But Hazrat Shaykh Nawarullah Umraqadu, Shaykh Muhammad Zakariya rahmatullah alayh says, no, Bukhari is not indicating towards Abu Hanifa, he is indicating towards the Murji'ah. And we have just explained, Murji'ah said that amal is not part of Iman, whatever you do, you will go straight into Jannah, you won't go into Jahannam. This was their aqidah. Even today, well, we get people who are Murji'ah. You know, those people who say that, you know, sharab, kebab, drugs and all this, and still will go in Jannah. And they say that, oh, who has Allah made Jannat for? And Jannat is for us, we're going to go Jannat anyway. So this is called Murji'ah. So Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi was never a holder of that view. And so the indication is not towards Imam Abu Hanifa. The indication is towards the Murji'ah, the ghulat of Murji'ah, who separated them both and said that you will go to Jannah whatever you do. So Imam Bukhari is doing his rad and criticizing upon them, not on Abu Hanifa. And in many places, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi has agreed with Imam Abu Hanifa and not with the other a'imma. In many places, for example, in Kitabu Zakat, when the masla comes about ushr upon the harvest, all the a'immas, Shafi'i, Malik, they all say, you only have to give 1/10 to the fuqara when the harvest reaches a particular limit of khamsatu awsuq. If it's less than khamsatu awsuq, you don't need to give to the poor. But Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah is of the opinion that whatever the land produces, whatever harvest you get, whether it is little or whether it's more, you have to give 1/10 to the fuqara. Now Imam Sa'd's mazhab is more beneficial for the fuqara. Because even if you have a small garden and you get a little bit of products, you will still give 1/10 to the fuqara. Whereas over there, you will have to have so many tons, then from that you will have to give to the fuqara. So that is nisab according to Shafi'i, Malik and the others. But according to Imam Abu Hanifa, there is no nisab for the produce of the land and the cultivation and the harvest. You have to give a tenth of anything you harvest. So Imam Bukhari agrees with the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah. And he makes a chapter in Kitabul Zakat, goes with that. In many masail. And Imam Bukhari's opinion is exactly the same as Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh. With regards to naqlu zakat min baladin ila balad, the Aimma says you can't send one zakat of one city to another city. If Abu Hanifa says if there is more need in another city, you can do so. Bukhari rahmatullah alayh agrees with the opinion of Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh that you can send zakat to another city if there is more need over there and send it there. So many masail, Imam Bukhari agrees. It's not that Imam Bukhari is always against Abu Hanifa and there is something between them. No, that's not the case like people make it. Abu Hanifa and Bukhari, Imam Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi came at a later date. He was born in 194 after Hijrah. Nearly 50 years after Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi passed away. And he passed away in the year 256. So the era of Imam Bukhari rahmatullah is nearly 100 years difference between their era. So Imam Bukhari had a different opinion in some masail. That does not mean that he is criticizing Abu Hanifa. We should not give such an impression to the Ummah. Imam Bukhari is Imam Bukhari. He did his work. May Allah shower his mercy upon him. Mm-hmm. And Abu Hanifa did his work. May Allah shower his mercy upon him. Mm-hmm. And these types of things should not be said. Moving on, he said that, I don't know where Abu Hanifa is. He's in Jannah or he's in Nar. Allah Akbar. He says such words with regards to Sahaba as well. He said that Sahaba used to take revolt against Aimma, and people Khawarij of today take dalil from Abu Hanifa's call and from the call of Aisha and Talha and Zubair, who went against Ali. So they say Aisha and Talha and Ali did this, so we can do it as well. No. So he uses that word, and then he says that no, but Aisha and Talha and Zubair were forgiven because radiallahu anhum, they will not be held to account no matter whether they did zina or rape or murder, they will still be forgiven. How can you say such words regarding Sahaba? You should have some respect for the Sahaba. It's not for the Aimma. And over here with Abu Hanifa, he says, I don't know whether he's in Jannah or he's in Nar. And with Obama, I don't know, Obama, if he comes on Hidayat, he can go into Jannah. Now, these types of comparisons, they don't suit a scholar. And a scholar should be very careful of what he says. May Allah give Hidayat to the whole Ummah. Moving on, another criticism he makes is that Abu Hanifa, with regards to Abu Hanifa, people do ghulu and exaggerate. And they say that he used to recite the Quran 60 times during the month of Ramadan. So if he taught from Fajr to night, then when did he get time? It is against the Sunnah and prohibited. Prophet didn't do it, so we shouldn't do it as well. This is his criticism of Imam Abu Hanifa. First of all, where is this? Is this right or wrong that Abu Hanifa finished 60 Quran in Ramadan? Well, Khatib Baghdadi Ramtulali has narrated in Tariq Baghdad on page 357. And Yahya ibn Nasr, قال, كان أبو حنيفة ربما ختم القرآن في شهر رمضان 60 ختمة. He has narrated with his chain that Abu Hanifa Ramtulali in Ramadan, many a time, he didn't say always, ربما, sometimes or many times, finished the Quran in the month of Ramadan 60 times throughout the month of Ramadan. That is once in the day, once during the night. Now, is this possible or not possible? People say it's not possible. Prophet didn't do it. So why should we do it? Allahu Akbar. You know, get this out of your mind. That Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam liked many things, but he didn't do it deliberately. So they are allowed in Sharia. There is no harm in there. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came for Hajjatul Wada. He arrived on the 4th of Zilhijjah. And there were 4 days left before going to Mina, but Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not perform a single nafil tawaf. He did not perform tawaf of Baytullah, even though he liked it. Because if he were to do it, then the ummah would think that this is something necessary, and they would be troubled. And he wanted to make things easy for the ummah. So he didn't do it. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, maybe he didn't finish the Quran in the whole night, because he didn't want to put the ummah in trouble. But he has spent sleepless nights in worshipping. And he has spent the whole night in worshipping. Many a times with the Sahaba, in the hadith of Abu Dharr, he started his salah in Ramadan after Isha, and hatta khashina yafutan al falah, until Sahri was at risk as well, that we will get suhoor or not. And immediately went home, suhoor, came back to Fajr salah. So he performed throughout the whole night. And in many hadith, he performed nearly 6-7 juz in one rakat. So the basis is there. And it was not only Imam Abu Hanifa Ramtullali who used to recite so much Quran. Allahu Akbar. That era was such an era. Imam Shafi Ramtullali used to recite 60 khatm in the Quran. Imam Bukhari Ramtullali used to recite 40 khatms in the in 40 khatms in Ramadan. Read Hadith Sari Muqaddama of Fathul Bari. Hafiz ibn Hajar Asqalani Ramtullali writes that Imam Bukhari would complete one recitation throughout the day, every day, throughout the month of Ramadan. And in the evening at Maghrib time, Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq and Qul a'udhu bi rabbil nas would be on his lips every single day. And he said after Isha, Imam Bukhari would start his salah, and in that salah he would read 10 juz al aqal, thuluth al Quran. And every third day he would be making a khatm of the Quran. Hafiz ibn Hajar has narrated this in Hadith Sari. So that era was such. Sa'id ibn Jubair, Sa'id ibn Musayyib, they were great ubbad. Imam Abdul Hayy al-Laknawi rahmatullah has written a book called Iqamatul Hujja ala anna al-ikthara min al-ibadati laysa bi-bid'ah. And in that he narrates all these narrations of so-and-so, big list of all those tabi'een and tabi'i tabi'een who used to spend the whole night in worship, who used to recite the Quran throughout the day, throughout the night, Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash and so-and-so, how much Quran they used to recite. Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash, Imam Bukhari rahmatullah, Imam Nawawi narrates in Muslim, with regards, when he was dying on his deathbed, his sister was crying. And he opened his eyes and he said, sister, don't cry. In this corner, your brother has recited the Quran 24,000 times. So these are the era was such of worship. Today people don't want to worship. People have time for everything else. Their leisure, sport, and they don't want to, and they don't want to let anybody else worship as well. So Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi used to recite khatm of Quran throughout the day and night. This is narrated by Baghdadi in his tarikh. They also went on to say that he performed salah of fajr with the wudu of isha for 40 years. No. Abu Usama says this is not possible. How can this be possible? Now let me tell you, my friends, this is possible. Try it for one night. In England, summer, it will be very possible. Winter, it might be hard. But in summer, the night is very, you know, short. 10 o'clock Maghrib, 4 o'clock Fajr, you can do it. So, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi did it. Now, when you say something that someone did this practice for 40 years, it doesn't mean that every day, whatever happens. It means that this was his general habit, general routine. If someday he's ill or sick, or someday he's on a journey, he's out, that those days will be exempted. But generally, his normal habit was this. For example, someone would say, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Madina Munawwara, and for 10 years he did this. Meaning that was his general habit. For 10 years he did Qurbani on every Eid. So we will say it was his general habit. When he was there, he did the Qurbani. When he wasn't there, he was on a journey, he was in Makkah on Hajjatul Wada, he did not do it. But his normal habit was in Medina for 10 years, he did the Qurbani. Similarly, when you say that Abu Hanifa did this for 40 years, then that means it was his general habit. And where is this narrated? You can't do this. Don't just reject anything due to your own qiyas and your own logic. When there is narration there, look at it. Where is it? Tariqh Baghdad, 354, volume 6. An Asad ibn Amr, qala salla Abu Hanifa fima hufidha alayhi salat al-fajr bi wudu' al-isha'i 40 sanatan. Asad ibn Amr says that it has been preserved regarding Abu Hanifa that he prayed Fajr Salah with the wudu of Isha for 40 years. Baghdadi narrates in another place that ولما مات غسله الحسن بن عمارة فقال رحمك الله لم تفطر منذ 30 سنة ولم تتوسد يمينك بالليل منذ 40 سنة وقد أتعبت من بعدك وفضحت القراء. That Hassan ibn Umara gave ghusl to the body of Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. And while giving ghusl, he said, may Allah show mercy to you, O Abu Hanifa. You never went without Sawm and with Iftar for 30 years. Throughout those times, you always kept Sawm throughout the day for 30 years. And for 40 years, you never laid your side on a pillow throughout the night. And you have put those after you in great difficulty. And you have disgraced the other Huffaz and Qurra. They should take lesson from you who sleep throughout the night and don't wake up for tahajjud. They should learn from you. Now, why did this happen? Why did Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi pray Salatul Fajr with the wudu of Isha for 40 years? Tariqh Baghdadi, Khatib Baghdadi narrates from Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi that Imam Abu Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi says, we were once walking with Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, and there were two ladies talking among themselves, and they said, you know this man, this is Abu Hanifa. He never sleeps throughout the night. He's always awake. So, Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi said, wallahi, la yatahaddathu an-nasu anni bima lam af'al. Wallah, people will not talk about me regarding something which I don't do. When people are saying this, then I must do it. And he prayed to Allah, oh Allah, oh Allah, you don't sleep, you are Hayyu Qayyum, your malaika angels don't sleep, and you have the ability to give me the power to, not fall asleep. Please give me the ability so I can worship you throughout the night. And he made a special dua after Salatul Hajat, and he made an attempt that I want to do this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported him. Many incidents are narrated by Mis'al ibn Kidam regarding his ma'mulat, Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Abu Yusuf, Yahya ibn Fudayl. They all say different incidents. That I saw Abu Hanifa, I left him in the masjid. When I came back in the morning for Fajr, he was still there in that condition and he was busy in his salah. Over here, Kharija ibn Mus'ab says, خَتَمَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي الْكَعْبَةِ أَرْبَعَةٌ مِنَ الْأَيْمَةِ. Four great people recited the whole Quran inside Kaaba Sharif. Narrated by Khatib Baghdadi on page 356. عثمان بن عفان تميم الداري وسعيد بن جبير وابو حنيفه. عثمان بن عفان تميم داري بوث صحابه، سعيد بن جبير تابعي كبار التابعين، ابو حنيفه صغار التابعين. They all finished the whole recital of Quran inside Kaaba Sharif. They are among them. So this is no hearsay. This is not just any fiction or anything. This is supported by narrated by these ulama and great people. And what you call Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi was of such a nature. Moving on, another thing said that some scholars wrote books against him. Ibn Hazm wrote book Al-Muhalla. Allah. But Ibn Hazm's book Al-Muhalla, I have it at home, 12 big volumes. And it's not just against Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi. Ibn Hazm's book is of the masail of Sharia. And Ibn Hazm's book is, you know, in his book, he has a particular view. And anyone who opposes that view, Ibn Hazm uses that butti talwar upon him. You know, he just says, whether it's Abu Hanifa or whether it's Shafi or Malik or Ahmad ibn Hanbal or anyone. In fact, whether it's Abu Bakr or Umar. When some hadith comes, Ibn Hazm says, well, hadith says this, Abu Bakr, Umar, who is Abu Bakr, who is Umar? Rasulullah said this, we will go with what Abu, Rasulullah said. So Abu Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri's nature is of this type. And Ibn Hazm did not write just against Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi. He had a particular fiqh of his, and due to that, he wrote that book, and he opposed the views of many of the a'imma. He had his own view. May Allah have mercy upon him and shower his mercy upon his grave. He did good work. There is good points to take from Al-Muhalla. Alhamdulillah, I have used it on many occasions. So it's not just against Abu Hanifa. Claim that it was against Abu Hanifa, this is wrong. Ibn Abi Shayba in his Kitab al-Musannaf has a chapter in his book where he went against Sunnah. He wrote about Abu Hanifa. Similarly, we can finish him off. Ibn Abi Shayba rahmatullahi alayhi narrates in his al-Musannaf that Abu Hanifa many times went against Hadith. And he says, in Hadith says so and so, but Abu Hanifa said this. In this book, Makanatul Imam Abi Hanifa bin al-Muhaddisin, Ustad Dr. Muhammad Abduh al-Hadisi, on page 318, he starts off from there and he says that first of all, Ibn Abi Shayba's objections can be summarized into 6 points. And after those 6 points, we can take all those ahadith which he has mentioned, and he mentions nearly 125 examples. And from those examples, what he does is, he brings the quote of Ibn Abi Shayba, the hadith which he brings, and then he's rug upon Abu Hanifa. Then Dr. Muhammad Abdul Harsi in his doctorate and his PhD, he brings the dalil of Abu Hanifa. And then he brings at the end who has agreed with Abu Hanifa on this masala. That Abu Hanifa said this, but so and so also agree with Abu Hanifa. So in this way, he gives the answer and reply to the objections of Ibn Abi Shayba. And in all of them, the haqq is with Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi alayhi. And he says that whatever Ibn Abi Shayba has narrated and the objections he has made, they can be referred to 6 points. Number one, the hadith which Ibn Abi Shayba narrates is da'if. In comparison to the hadith which Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi has, it's a sahih hadith. Number two, there is difference of opinion among the sahaba. So Abu Shayba, Ibn Abi Shayba brings a call, verdict of sahabi, not a hadith, verdict of sahabi. But Abu Hanifa also has a verdict of another sahabi. So there is, when there are difference of sahaba, you can take from whichever you choose, whichever you feel is more closer to Quran and hadith. Not whichever is more close to your desire, what you like and your whim. No, which is more closer to Quran and hadith. Number three, many a times the masla is referred to ijtihad and ikhtilaf in the understanding of the hadith. Ibn Abi Shayba's understanding is different, Abu Hanifa's understanding is different. And when you scrutinize it, you will know that Abu Hanifa's understanding is much more better than the understanding of Ibn Abi Shayba. Ibn Abi Shayba came later on. He is the ustad of Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi. He is the student of the students of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi. And Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi is much, much more closer to the era of Rasulullah with a better understanding. And this is not. And number four, many a times Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi looks at the general maslihat and generalizing the maslihat of al-amma, al-awam. That what is better and for the awam ul-muslimin, not for the khawas. Like in the masala of which I have mentioned about ushr, that what is more general, what is better for the general public. So Ibn Abi Shayba's view is restricted to a particular channel. Abu Hanifa's view is more broader. That is why Imam Abu Hanifa's view was not understood by Ibn Abi Shayba, and that's why he objected. And number five, many a times there is a hadith, but Imam Abu Hanifa Ramtullah was very strict in accepting sahih hadith. He would say that only those ahadith should be accepted which the narrator remembers from the day he hears it to the day he narrates it. If he forgot it in between, then that will not be reliable. He should have it in his memory from the day he heard it to the day he narrates it. There was a very strict condition for hadith. Not all people can do that. This was Imam Abu Hanifa's condition. So many a time there are some strict sharait of Abu Hanifa with regards to acceptance of hadith. And number six, in the sixth point is that sometimes Ibn Abi Shayba objects on something, saying this is Abu Hanifa's madhab. But in reality, that is not Abu Hanifa's madhab, that is something else. He thinks it's Abu Hanifa's madhab and then he objects over it. When you keep these 6 points in mind, then all the masail refer to these 6 points and you can give reply to them. And Ustad Dr. Muhammad Abdul Al-Hadisi went through all of them and gave very beautiful answer to them. We should all, you know, all the students who are here, you should buy this book. This is very good. Makanatul Imam Abi Hanifa Bayn Al-Muhaddithin, Dr. Muhammad Abdul Al-Hadisi. So this is some of the objections, and there are other things which can be said as well. I think this is enough for the answers of the criticism made by this person called Abu Usama Az-Zahab. Just with regards to finishing off of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, what type of person he was, how the ulama have praised him. I mentioned to you that Ibn Abdul Barr in his Al-Intiqa, Babu ma zukira, Babu zikri man taha ilayna min thana'il ulama ala Abi Hanifa wa tafdhilihim lahu. Praise of Abu Hanifa and they are giving excellence to Abu Hanifa. Abu Ja'far Muhammad ibn Ali ibn al-Husayn. Imam Abu Ja'far Muhammad al-Baqir, who is known as Muhammad al-Baqir. That once Imam Abu Hamza al-Sumali says, we were with Abu Ja'far Muhammad ibn Ali. Abu Hanifa came and he asked Abu Ja'far Muhammad ibn Ali with regards to some masail, and Muhammad ibn Ali replied. Then Abu Hanifa went out. Then Abu Ja'far made a remark to us, مَا أَحْسَنَ هَدِيَهُ وَسَمْتَهُ وَمَا أَكْثَرَ فِقَهُ. How beautiful is his mannerism and his akhlaq and characteristics, and how beautiful and how excellent and more is his understanding and his fiqh. He also narrates, أن أبي حنيفة أن أبا جعفر محمد بن علي حدثه أن عليا دخل على عمر وهو مسجن عليه بثوب فقال ما من أحد أحب إلي أن ألقى الله بصحيفته من هذا المسجى بردائه. الحديث from Imam Muhammad al-Baqir. حماد بن أبي سليمان مسعر بن كدام. He said رحم الله أبا حنيفة إن كان لفقيها عالما. He was a faqih and an عالم. Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani, Hamad ibn Zayd says, أَرَدْتُ الْحَجَّ. Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani was from Basra, and Abu Hanifa was from Kufa. So Hamad ibn Zayd al-Basri says, أَرَدْتُ الْحَجَّ. I intended to go for Hajj. فَأَتَيْتُ أَيُّوب وَدِّعُهُ. I came to bid farewell to Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani, my ustad. He said to me, بلغني أن فقيه أهل الكوفة أبا حنيفة يريد الحج فإذا لقيته فأقرئه مني السلام. فأقرئه مني السلام. I have heard that the faqih of Ahle Kufa, Abu Hanifa, is also going for Hajj. If you happen to meet him, then give him my salams. This is Ayyub Sakhtiyani sending salams. Al-A'mash says, اذهب خرج الأعمش يريد الحج فلما صار بالحيرة قال لعلي بن مسهر اذهب إلى أبي حنيفة حتى يكتب لنا المناسك. That A'mash went for Hajj. When he arrived at Hira, name of a place, he said to Ali ibn Musir, go to Abi Hanifa and tell him to write a summary of the masail of Hajj for us. A'mash telling his student to write a summary of the masail, short masail of Hajj for him. This is narrated by whom? Ibn Abdul Barr in Al-Intiqa. He says, سمعت الأعمش وسئل عن مسألة فقال إنما يحسن الجواب في هذا ومثله النعمان بن ثابت الخزاز أراه بولك له في علمه. He said, I see that his ilm has been, he has been given barakat and blessing in his ilm. Shubba ibn al-Hajjaj, Shababa ibn Sawwar says, كَانَ شُعْبَةُ حَسَنَ الرَّأِيَ فِي أَبِي حَنِيفَ and some others, Sufyan Thawri, Mughira ibn Miqsam al-Dabbi, and Hassan ibn Salih ibn Hay, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Sa'id ibn Abi Aruba, Hamad ibn Zayd, Qazi Shariq, Hamad ibn Zayd said, حَدَّثَنَا سُلَيْمَانُ بْنُ حَرْبٍ قال سمعت حماد بن زيد يقول والله إني لأحب أبا حنيفة لحبه لأيوب وروى حماد بن زيد عن أبي حنيفة أحاديث كثيرة. حماد بن زيد said والله I love أبو حنيفة because he loves my أستاذ أيوب سختياني. And حماد بن زيد narrated many أحاديث from إمام أبو حنيفة رحمة الله عليه. قاضي شريك سمعت شريكا النخعي يقول كان أبو حنيفة طويل الصمت دائم الفكر قليل المحادثة للناس. Ibn Shubruma says, عجزت النساء أن تلد مثل النعمان. يحيى بن سعيد القطان. In fact, يحيى بن سعيد القطان used to give fatwa according to Abu Hanifa's life. Abdullah ibn Mubarak. His many ashar narrated over here. رأيت أبا حنيفة كل يوم يزيد نباهة ويزيد خيرا وينطق بالصواب ويصطفيه إذا ما قال أهل الجور جورا يقايس من يقايسه بلب ومن ذا تجعلون له نظيرا كفانا فخر حماد وكانت مصيبتنا به أمرا كبيرا رأيت أبا حنيفة حين يؤتى ويطلب علمه بحرا غزيرا إذا ما المشكلات تدافعتها رجال العلم كان بها بصيرا. These are narrated by Abu Ibn Abdul Barr from Abdullah ibn Mubarak, his ashar with regards to praise of Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh. Qasim ibn Ma'an, Hujr ibn Abdul Jabbar, Zuhair ibn Muawiyah, Ibn Jurayj, Abdul Razak ibn Hammam, Imam Shafi'i praising Abu Hanifa. Waqi' ma ra'aytu mithla Waqi' wa kana yufti bi ra'yi Abi Hanifa. Khalid al-Wasiti, Al-Fadl ibn Musa al-Sinani, Isa ibn Yusuf, Yunus, he says, Wallahi ma ra'aytu afdala minhu, wala awra'a minhu, wala afqaha minhu. I have not seen anyone more virtuous than him, more pious than him, and more wise and with jurisprudence, more understanding of jurisprudence than him. Abdul Hamid ibn Abdul Rahman al-Himani, Ma'mar ibn Rashid, Nadr ibn Muhammad, Yunus ibn Abi Ishaq, Israel ibn Yunus, Zufar ibn Huzayl, Usman al-Barri, Jalil ibn Abdul Hamid, Abu Muqatil, Abu Yusuf al-Qazi, Salim ibn Salim, Yahya ibn Adam, Yazid ibn Harun, ibn Abi Rizma, Sa'id ibn Salim al-Qadda', Shaddad ibn Hakim, Kharija ibn Mus'af, Khalab ibn Ayyub, Abu Abdul Rahman al-Muqri, Muhammad ibn Sa'ib al-Kalbi, Hasan ibn Umara, Abu Nu'aym al-Fadl ibn Dukayn, Hakam ibn Hisham, Yazid ibn Zuray, Abdullah ibn Dawud al-Khuraybi, Muhammad ibn Fudayl, Zakariya ibn Abi Zaida, ibn Yahya ibn Zakariya, Zaida ibn Qudama, Yahya ibn Ma'in, Malik ibn Mughwal, Abu Bakr ibn Ayyash, Abu Khalid al-Ahmar, Qais ibn Rabi, Abu Asim al-Nabil, Ubaydullah ibn Musa, Muhammad ibn Jabir, Asma'i, Shaqiq Balkhi, Ali ibn Asim, Yahya ibn Nasr, 67 people praised him. And if you add to them Imam Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani and some which are left, you can go over 70. All these people praising Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah. Someone will say he was a very pious person, but also with regards to his high position in hadith as well. Let me tell you a little bit about his high position in hadith. Makki ibn Ibrahim says, Kana Abu Hanifa ta'alama ahli zamani. He was the greatest knowledgeable person among his people of his time. Abu Yusuf says, ما رأيت أعلم بتفسير الحديث منه كان أبصر بالحديث الصحيح مني. He had more basirat and insight into hadith sahih than myself. Imam Tirmizi narrates that Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi said, ما رأيت أكذب من جابر الجعفي ولا أفضل من عطاء بن أبي رباح. This is a statement with regards to a narrator of two narrators of hadith. Bayhaqi says that Sufyan Thawri that Imam Abu Hanifa was asked with regards to taking hadith from Sufyan Thawri. Can we take hadith from Sufyan Thawri? And Abu Hanifa replied, "Uktub anhu, fa innahu thiqatun ma ada Abi Ishaq and Jabir al-Jufi." Take hadith from Sufyan Thawri because he is a thiqa, reliable. However, don't take his hadith of Abu Ishaq from Jabir al-Jufi. Because Sufyan Thawri was a bit lenient with regards to Jabir Jaufi. So Abu Hanifa said, don't take Jabir Jaufi's riwayat from Sufyan Thawri. Yeah. And Yahya ibn Adam said, كَانَ النُّعْمَانَ جَمَعَ حَدِيثَ بَلَدِهِ كُلَّهُ فَنَظَرَ إِلَىٰ آخِرِ مَا قُبِضَ عَلَيْهِ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Abu Yusuf's other statement, Amash's statement, and Abu al-Muhasin al-Dimashqi al-Shafi'i's statement, Sha'rani's statement, Ibn Khaldun's statement, Yahya ibn Nasr's statement, and Waqi ibn al-Jarrah's statement. Abu Ja'far al-Mansur once asked Abu Hanifa, عَمَّنْ أَخَسْتَ الْعِلْمِ, from whom did you take your knowledge? And he said, عَنْ أَصْحَابِ عُمَرْ عَنْ عُمَرْ وَعَنْ أَصْحَابِ عَلِي عَنْ عَلِي وَعَنْ أَصْحَابِ إِبْنِ مَسْعُودْ عَنْ إِبْنِ مَسْعُودْ. So Mansur said, لَقَدْ إِسْتَوْثَقْتَ, you have held on to very reliable authorities. Khatib Baghdadi says, Sufyan ibn Uyayna said, أَوَّلُ مَنْ أَقْعَدَنِي لِلْحَدِيثِ بِالْكُوفَةِ أَبُو حَنِيفَ قَالَ لِلنَّاسِ هَذَا أَعْلَمُ النَّاسِ بِحَدِيثِ عَمْرِ بْنِ دِينَارِ. The first person to make me sit in the Jami Masjid of Al-Kufa to teach hadith was Abu Hanifa. He brought me and he said to people, this person knows the has the most knowledge of the hadith of Amr ibn Dinar, so learn from him. So this is Abu Hanifa, he is telling Sufyan ibn Uyayna to sit down and teach hadith. He is being asked about Sufyan Thawri, he is being asked about other people because of his knowledge of hadith. And many other statements. Muwaffaq said, "Intakhab al-athar min al-arba'in alf hadith." He narrated. He selected al-athar from 40,000 hadith which he had remembered. So these are all the ulama. There might be a question over here. Why is there so many hadith not narrated from Abu Hanifa in Sihaya Sitta? So we will say that. Tell me how many hadith narrated from Shafi'i. From Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal is Bukhari's ustad. But Imam Bukhari in his whole sahih has only narrated maybe 6 places from Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Otherwise he takes from other. So these imams were great imams. Their ahadith had spread out. Their ahadith did not need to be narrated. So the others, their ahadith were taken by Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawud, Nasai. And plus, these imams did not sit down for narrating ahadith. They said they had other things they felt that other things had more priority, which is deriving masail. That is why ahadith are not narrated from them in such number as other muhaddithin. And this is one of the reasons. And you know, when you memorize too many ahadith without taking masail from them, is no good. Ram Hurmuzi narrates in Faqih al-Mutafaqih that Yahya ibn Ma'in, Khalaf ibn Ayyub and others were sitting. And a lady came and saw them debating about ahadith and riwayat. She asked a masla. And she said that, can a woman on menstruation give ghusl to a dead person? Dead lady. A lady has died. A lady on menstruation, can she give ghusl? And they started scratching their head. And they said, Aliq ibn Muqbil. You know that man who's coming, Abu Thawr? Ask him. He was a faqih. So when Abu Thawr arrived, she asked, is this right? He said, yes. She can't give ghusl because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ama inna hizataki laysat fi yadiki," your haiz is not in your hands. So he said that yes, it was his mother that is allowed. Abu Hanifa said it's makruh. A lady who is pak should give ghusl, but he said it's allowed, no problem. So they were saying, they started, "Oh yes, 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 this hadith of Aisha is narrated from so and so and from so and so." So the lady said, "Faina kuntum ila al-an? Where were you up to now? You didn't know the masla. Now you come to hadith, you are debating about the chain." So the chain is not as important as taking masail out. Same. This is more important. This is the work which Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, he has great ihsan and blessing upon the whole ummah. So people should stop criticizing Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, and value and cherish the good work he has done for the ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to respect Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad, Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam Tirmidhi, all our aslaf from today till the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Give us their true love and their respect, and keep us on their path till the day we die. And may Allah accept our sitting over here. Forgive us for any mistakes which we have made, or any word which we have said to hurt anyone. We try to avoid as much as we can, and we don't want to abuse anyone. But please forgive us if you feel bad. But this is the correct path, and you should understand, and stop criticizing Imam Abu Hanifa.